Good morning.
Good morning.
Can you hear a little better since I remembered to turn on the microphone system this week? I hope so. Welcome to worship, everyone, this morning. Good to have everyone here on this the fourth Sunday of the season of Advent, right before we celebrate Christmas. And hopefully you can return again on Friday at 5 o'clock for our Christmas Eve service of lessons and carols. That's always a special service. Hopefully many of you can come back for that one. I want to go over just a few announcements on the bulletin insert for today. First of all, tomorrow is the last day to order a book for our next short-term study. It's a book, Simon Peter, a six-week study by Adam Hamilton. And so if you'd like to order a copy of the book, whether you can come to the class or maybe just want to read it on your own, either way works. But we'll be ordering those so that we can have those on hand early in January so that you can get the reading assignments done for when the class starts moving toward the latter part of the month. I mentioned about the Lessons and Carols service. We are looking for people who might want to be readers for that service, read a scripture lesson for that service. So if that's something you might be willing to take on, just let me know after the service today. We'll try to get that list finalized tomorrow for who those readers are going to be. And then next Sunday, well, first of all, welcome back, Warren Townsend, who's back from hip surgery and doing well from that. And he will be preaching next Sunday morning as a special worship service lined up. Won't want to miss it, so hopefully you can come back next Sunday for that, and thanks in advance to Warren for filling in for me next week. We continue to receive our Christmas offering. Again, this year it's to the Adopt-a-Family program that goes toward families in the community that don't have very many resources, and helps them buy some Christmas presents and have a little nicer Christmas than they might otherwise have. So there are Christmas Joy offering envelopes for that. Just two other quick things. For committee chairs, Alberta would love it if you could turn in your year-end report as soon as possible so she can start compiling those. And then a little bit different this year for our poinsettias for Christmas. This year, along with the supply chain problems with all sorts of other things, the cost of poinsettias just skyrocketed, like double, triple, you know, from what they had been in previous years. So we didn't want to buy a whole bunch of them, but we wanted to have some to decorate the sanctuary. If you would like to help defray the cost of the ones that we did buy, please see Susie, and she would gladly accept a donation. Anyone else have announcements you need to make today? Oh, I'm sorry, Susan. Okay. Don't pay Susie, pay the church.
Please join me in our call to worship. It is a responsive reading found in your bulletin. We are the community of the third day.
Lord, raise us up from all of us.
We are a Sunday people.
Lord, raise us up to what is.
The cradle could not keep him. The cross could not kill him. The tomb could not hold him.
Because he lives, we shall also live.
Emmanuel, come.
Yes.
Please stand as you're able for our first hymn, which is number 140 in our hymnal, Once in Royal David's City.
Thank you. too little in the present. We expect life only in the future and miss the life we have now. Let our yesterdays and our tomorrows use up our days. Forgive us, Lord.
Emmanuel has come to bring what was and will be to what is. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven.
Let us sing glory to God. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. Today we remember Joseph, worn-out traveler and worried husband, doing what was necessary for the sake of his family, the burden of poverty stifling his hope in the promise of God. There was no room for him, yet he knows to whom he belongs. Today we give thanks for the Josephs among us, migrating far from home when there is no choice, fiercely devoted to the ones they love, unwavering in their belief that there is room for all in the kingdom of God.
I think we don't have any little kids here today, so we'll move past the gospel for God's children to the next prayer for illumination of the scripture.
Let us pray for illumination. Astonishing God, send your Holy Spirit among us as we wait the coming of your Son. Fill us with good things that we may conceive your reign on earth and glorify you according to your word. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 7, verses 18 through 32. Page 730 in your pew Bible or 1471 in the large print. Jesus and John the Baptist. John's disciples told him about all these things. Calling two of them, he sent them to the Lord to ask, "Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?" When the men came to Jesus, they said, "John the Baptist sent us to ask, 'Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else?'" At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. So he replied to the messengers, "Go back and report to John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. Blessed is anyone who does not stumble on account of me." After John's messengers left, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who wear expensive clothes and indulge in luxury are in palaces. But what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." All the people, even the tax collectors, when they heard Jesus' words, acknowledged that God's way was right, because they had been baptized by John. But the Pharisees and the experts in the law rejected God's purpose for themselves, because they had not been baptized by John. Jesus went on to say, "To what then can I compare the people of this generation? What are they like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace and calling out to each other. We played the pipe for you, and you did not dance. We sang a dirge, and you did not cry. God bless to our understanding
this reading from God's holy word. And let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. There are many people who outwardly seem to have their lives all together. You know, they have plenty of money, lots of friends, a good deal of power. So on the surface of things, they appear to be leading the good life. But inwardly, many of those same people feel lost and alone and empty. Once there was a pastor, we'll call him Bill Smith, who was the pastor of a large and thriving congregation. Everybody loved Bill because day after day and night after night, Bill gave of himself endlessly. Bill had given of himself to his family as well as his church, and that was the problem. Bill had nothing left to give anyone else. He was burned out, fatigued, at the end of his rope. That was Bill Smith. Outwardly, the very successful pastor of a large church, but inwardly, a person who felt so lonely, so exhausted, and so empty, that he despaired of life itself. Desperate for some help, Bill found himself at the door of a nearby monastery, and he spent one afternoon pouring his heart out to one of the brothers there, who listened intently to what Bill had to say. When Bill finished, the brother said quietly, "Bill, you want to give living water to your people and to your family. You want to draw vast resources from God's well. But the problem is, your pipe doesn't go deep enough into the water. You are just drawing from the surface waters. And until you learn to go deep, you'll never be able to help yourself or anyone else." Bill Smith, even though he'd been a very successful pastor, symbolizes many people who are bored, burned out, empty, alone. It's just not pastors that happens to. There are people out in the pews that go through that same thing as well. There was once a little boy who was going to the funeral of his great aunt. And this aunt was not the most lovely of people. She was a little grouchy and grumpy and really didn't like little kids very much. And so when his mother was trying to comfort this small boy, she said to him, "Well, you know, Aunt Gladys has gone to heaven to be with God." And the small boy gave his mother a sympathetic look, shook his head, and said, "Oh, poor God." You know, when we're burned out and empty, it shows. Even if we go to church every single Sunday, if our lives are unfulfilled and we're unhappy, it shows to others.
If we ever find ourselves in that situation, what we need most is to be raised up by Jesus. There is this wonderfully tender line in the 11th chapter of the book of Hosea about the nature of God. God is speaking and says, I was like someone who lifts an infant up against his cheek. That middle picture, I was like someone who lifts an infant up against his cheek. Remember back when you were small enough for someone to lift you up? You may have to think back in ways. But remember when you were small enough for someone to lift you up off the ground? Remember that initial feeling of just gleeful joy and abandonment as you were being lifted up? And how that was followed by this feeling of terror, realizing that your feet had left the ground and you weren't quite sure what was going to happen next. And that was followed by this feeling of trust once you got closer to the face of the person who was lifting you up and you saw that it was someone who loved you. That's what God is like, says Hosea. God is like this person who lifts an infant and holds that infant close against their cheek. We experience those feelings when we feel especially close to God. That initial feeling of gleeful abandonment, joy, laughter, the terror as we become disoriented from being swooped up, and then the trust of having that face be recognized. If we hold on to that experience long enough. But sometimes, like little kids, we squirm to get free and get back on the ground. We don't hold on to the experience long enough to know that we can completely trust that face that has lifted us up. We need those times when we are lifted up, raised up by God. We need to be raised up from the past mistakes that we have made. We need to be raised up from those past mistakes so that we can make our way into the future that God wants for us. But so many of us are weighed down by things from the past. It's hard to move forward. Someone did us wrong, deserted us, hurt us in some way, and we can't seem to get over that to be able to move forward. God raises us up from that and gives us a new future. Yesterday afternoon, we were getting ready for this Christmas party at the man's, and I had a little golf tournament turned on, just a kind of playful, if you will, tournament, just kind of a father-son tournament. And Tiger Woods and his young son were playing in this golf tournament. And they were talking to Tiger Woods about what advice he's giving his son for playing golf. And he said, always keep your focus on the next shot. You know, Tiger Woods has had plenty of problems from his past, but he keeps moving forward. And maybe one of the things that made him a great golfer is when he would make a bad shot on the course, instead of dwelling on that shot and letting it affect every shot going forward, he was able to leave that in the past and move forward to the next shot. God gives us that ability to leave the past behind and move on to what's next. And we learn from the past, for sure, but
us the power to move forward. It's not just the bad things in our life that bind us, but sometimes it's the good things as well. Not only do we need to leave behind the negative experiences of our lives, we also need to not rest on our laurels, to think that we've done everything that there is to do, that we've finished all the tasks that God has before us, and so now we can just sit back and do nothing. That's as poisonous to our future as dwelling on a negative past. The Apostle Paul wrote this from a prison cell. He said, "The one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the call of God in Jesus Christ." I press on and keep moving forward. We are able to leave the past behind and press on toward the future when we have experienced that loving embrace of God. We felt like God has held us up to his cheek with warmth and love. It sets us free. It gives us hope. It changes how we view the rest of our lives. Pete Richards was the loneliest man in town. When little Gene opened the door to his shop one day, he had this shop of kind of antiques and collectibles, and in his front window he had a just disarray of things, from lockets and bracelets to little silver boxes and, you know, porcelain figurines, all sorts of things. And on this particular afternoon, little Jean just kept her face pressed to that front window for the longest time, until finally, with a satisfied air, she went into the store. "Mister," she began the conversation, "could I have that string of blue beads in the window?" Pete brought them out and showed them to her. "They're perfect," she said. "Now, could you wrap them up for me pretty, please?" Pete stared at her with a somewhat stony expression on his face. "Are you buying these for someone?" he asked. "Yes," she said, "they're for my sister. She's been taking care of me. This is the first Christmas since our mom died, and I wanted to do something nice for my sister." "How much money do you have?" Pete asked warily. Jean pulled out this handkerchief and unfolded it, and then spilled out a bunch of pennies onto the counter. She said, "You know, I opened up my piggy bank for this. It's everything I have." Pete Richards looked at the child thoughtfully. How could he tell this little girl that the pennies she had dropped on the counter weren't near enough to purchase this bracelet? And as he looked at this little girl with a trusting look in her blue eyes, something deep within Pete Richards began to come back to life. He looked at this little girl with the wheat-colored hair and blue eyes and remembered another woman who had the same kind of yellow streak in her hair and eyes, just as blue. That necklace
belongs to her. Until one rainy night, a truck skidding on a slippery road, and the life was crushed out of his dream. Since then, Pete Richards had lived with grief and bitterness that he tried to keep tucked away from the eyes of the world. The blue eyes of Jean jolted him into an acute awareness of just what he had lost. Then carefully, he wrapped the blue beads in scarlet paper and tied them with a bright green ribbon. "There you are," he said. "Don't lose them on the way home." The next few days were busy ones for Pete. All sorts of people were coming in doing, you know, last-minute Christmas shopping. But right before he was closing the shop on Christmas Eve, another woman came into the shop, pulled out a package, and said, "Did this necklace come from your shop?" He looked at it and said, "Yes, it was purchased here." "Then I must return it," the woman said, "because I know my sister did not have enough money to pay for this." Pete said, "The price is always confidential between the seller and the customer. The little girl who purchased this necklace paid the biggest price anyone could ever pay. She gave all she had. And what's more, as we're getting close to Christmas here, she reminded me of one who gave everything he had, who gave his life on the cross so that we might all have life." The one who changes all things, whose birth we celebrate, can change you and me for the better. God can raise us up to new lives if we open up our hearts to God and really see how God is already at work in our lives and the lives of others. So come, Lord Jesus. Come once again to raise us up, we pray. Come to raise us up. Our hymn is number 114, Away in a Manger, and following that, we'll have the affirmation of faith printed on a bulletin insert, so you might want to have that handy. As those who are able, please stand to sing. Thank you.
believe in the one who has come. We believe in God Almighty, who creates us with the gift of freedom and invites us to live fully, who endows us with the gift of hope and enables us to move toward what we cannot see, who remains the one sovereign Lord before whom we bow in reverence. We believe in God Almighty, who came to us as Jesus Christ, crucified and risen, and now comes again to live in our hearts and raise up our lives to his honor and glory. World, Marie Scovel, and Donna and Jerry Stiegel. So those are back for you to sign today. On our prayer card for today, one addition, the family of Van Dollison, and then an update on Al Sewell. Al was having hip surgery this past Monday, and apparently from a previous hip surgery, there was a long screw and I'm not sure if they were trying to realign that screw or remove it, but somehow it nicked an artery, and there was quite a bit of bleeding that happened with that, so they had to kind of halt the surgery and tried it again Wednesday, but in the meantime, Al's also had a stroke, so all sorts of health issues for Al right now, and please especially keep Al in your prayers as he goes through his struggles right now. And then I didn't mention last week, but I wanted to this week, all of the people who have been victims of some of the storms, particularly the tornadoes in Kentucky, that have just been so severe, wiped out towns or big portions of towns. And always people ask, well, what can we do? And the answer is, well, you've probably already done something. Right now we're receiving the Adopt a Family special offering, but around Easter time every year we receive the One Great Hour of Sharing offering, and part of that offering goes to help with disaster assistance. So, the money you gave last Easter for One Great Hour of Sharing probably went to help folks in Kentucky and other places that were hit hard by storms. So, when One Great Hour of Sharing comes up again, you'll know that you're giving kind of in advance of the next disaster to come along. Anybody else have any updates on people on our prayer card or new people to add today? Yes, Donna. Thanks from Donna Rothke for the congregational support after the death of her sister. Any others? Okay, let's then all come before God in prayer. Source of salvation, your name is holy. From you comes forth one who shall govern your people. As a shepherd calls his sheep, so will your servant call humanity to come and enter into sanctuary, where they may dwell secure. There they shall be nourished by the word of your covenant, and surrounded with hope that you abide in their midst. Their day shall be spent following the shepherd's command. Their night will pass quickly as they rest secure in your love. We give thanks that we may be numbered among those through whom Christ, the one you have chosen, has called us. We seek to be faithful to the call we receive. We pray for courage to respond to Christ's will in spite of the risk. Make us persistent in our ministry as a shepherd in search of lost sheep. Where persons are lost or bewildered, help us to stand as shining rays of hope. to those who wander aimlessly or unsure of themselves. Let us bring fresh esteem, clarity of mind, and renewed purpose. To those beguiled by false hopes and vain promises, our prayer is that your Spirit will impart wise counsel and true hope. For those who are pursued and attacked by ruthless forces, we pray for determination and strength that will come to their aid. Make us worthy in all that we do to bear the stamp of your approval and election. Secure in your love, may we be bold in facing the forces of evil. Nourished by your word, may we extend to all Christ the gift of new life. Fill our days with moments that please you, and our nights with the peace of the reconciled. We pray today, especially for those who have been the victims of recent storms, for the family of Dan Dollison, for Sylvia, Savannah, Nikki and Rick, Joan, John, Evelyn, Jim, Art, Alice and Joan, Al and his family, Lucinda, Warren, and John. And we pray for members of our church family this morning. We keep in our prayers Carl and Bonnie. All of these things we pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. In the book of Acts, we read, "Remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he himself said, 'It is more blessed to give than to receive.'" Let us take this offering time to think about those ways in which we might give to others in this coming week.
Today, number 136, Go Tell It All.
Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit.